No. 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 Yes, that's it.
Daddy, listen.
Live from the forest moon of Endor, Radio Free Endor, Star Wars Podcast, bringing you news and reviews from the galaxies far, far away.
Hello, and welcome to Radio Free Endor and this very special video. A couple of days ago, I had the pleasure to chat to a true creative force and a passionate storyteller. Of an illustrious career as an award-winning author and designer, his remarkable expertise and unwavering dedication to his craft have left a mark on the world of collecting toys and photography. He has also co-authored several books and has captivated the hearts of collectors and enthusiasts alike, but has also become an invaluable resource for anyone seeking to uncover the secrets and stories behind their favourite childhood treasures. Now he's about to embark on a fascinating journey through time and nostalgia with his latest endeavour, the groundbreaking Kickstarter book project My Palitoy Story. Collaborating with Bert Bratchin, his new book dives into the rich history of Palitoy. As you know, they made Star Wars figures. And it's all through the eyes of Bob, who worked there. Together, they will reveal the captivating tale of Palitoy's connection to the beloved 3¾-inch action figures, like Action Force. In the pages of My Palitoy Story, his masterful entwines the meticulous research, vivid and storytelling, and a genuine love for the subject matter. Through Bob's words, we are transported back to a time when action figures sparked our imagination and became steadfast companions on our countless adventures. The immersive journey not only sheds light onto the birth and evolution of Palitoy, but also offers a profound explanation to the profound impact that the toys had on generations of fans. It is a true honor to have him with us today. A visionary whose work has not only documented history, but has breathed life into cherished memories. Join us as we celebrate his remarkable achievements, as we explore the magic and wonder of collecting toys. And we are eagerly anticipating the release of My Palitoy Story, a book that promises to be the treasured addition to any enthusiast's library. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to the brilliant Brian Hickey. With Brian Hickey. How are you doing, Brian? Welcome to Radio Free Endor.
I'm doing great, Jamie. Thanks so much for having me on the show tonight.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have you on. Now, to some of our viewers, I've just read out a bit that I wrote about Visa, but for, you know, tell the viewers about yourself from your own mouth, you could say. What you've been up to.
It's always easier talking about projects than it is talking about myself. But you know, I suppose for a lot of your viewers who maybe you know, wouldn't know me, I'm a designer and a photographer, and I've done a lot of photography with toys. I've done a lot of design work in the toy industry, or some design work in the toy industry, I should say, working for Boss White Studio in particular, helping them the design of some of their packaging of their products. But I suppose what I'm probably, you know, better known for in the collecting community would be the books I've done with my colleague Paddy Lennon on collectible toys, specifically Action Force. We've done two books focused on Action Force. We've also done books about the modern era G.I. Joe figures, and also Boss White Studios Fantasy Wave figures. Greek mythology wave figures, I should say.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And the Fantasy Wave stuff is another project in the works for a future time. Personally, I've through my own photography, which I share on my Instagram account, I've done a lot of Star Wars focus photography on that, so that I share that on Instagram, and that's up on my website as well. And I suppose bringing it back to my connection then with Bob, Bob is someone that I've met at kind of Action Force conventions over the years, and then kind of more recently, myself and Paddy interviewed Bob for the Total Action Force book, the first volume, the first edition. And while we were talking to Bob, you know, about his career at Palitoy, he did mention to me that he was working on his own history of Palitoy. And we're going back to 2021 when we were having this conversation. Mm-hmm. And I had offered to Bob that if he ever wanted to do, you know, to create a book of that history of Palitoy that he was working on, that I would love to collaborate with him as the designer and to help him design the book and get it out there. So, you know, that was it. There was no further conversation about it. And then late in 2022, Bob got back in touch to say that he had the book at a first draft completed, and would I still be interested in it coming on board as a designer and to help him get the book out there, in physical form. So I jumped at the chance to do that. It was an honor to be able to work with Bob on a project like this. So that's really where we're at this stage. So we've been spending a few months kind of, you know, planning, getting together some, you know, photographic content that we need for the book, putting the Kickstarter together. And then the Kickstarter has gone live only recently. And I realize I've probably jumped way ahead and I've answered way more than your first question.
No, that's fine. No, I tell you what, let's, I like the Kickstarter to the stream, because that's basically what we're here for. So here we go. So this Kickstarter, it's at £19,316, and it's, it was at the goal pledge is £39,900.
Okay.
That seems quite, you might as well just put it to forte. That's like one of those, you know, when you go and buy something, it's like at 99 pence, because they think 99 pence sounds an awful lot cheaper than a pound.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I see that that's actually converting it, because obviously when I set up the Kickstarter, I set it up in euro because I'm based in Ireland. So I'm seeing it converted to pounds here on your screen. So it's kind of weird for me seeing the pounds, and I'm trying to translate that in my head, what that equates to. But yeah, it looks like it should be just an even 40K.
Yeah. Bob, I did reach out to Bob as well, and Bob, I think he's on holiday at the moment, so he couldn't make it. But he said that he wished us well and to record and talk about it. But later today, hopefully, we'll be able to get Bob on and yourself again, Brian, and we'll go over the book from his point of view as well. Because I've got a little bit of connection with Palitoy myself. Because at the moment, I live up in West Yorkshire at the moment. At the moment, what I'm saying, I've been here like 20 years. What I'm saying, this sounds like I just moved up here, right? But I was born and bred in Leicester, and I've got I feel like Palitoy's in my blood, because all my toys were from Palitoy, and I have got a couple of interesting stories about Palitoy, and thanks to my mum actually. But we'll probably dive into that a bit later on. But I just wanted to go down in to have a look at this book. Because you've designed this book, the design, the look of it, the cover and everything, and you've also took all the photos for it, I take it, for the whole book, yeah?
Obviously, I am contributing a lot of photography to the book, but it's not all going to be my photography. There's historical photos in there from, you know, photos that will go back to, you know, early 20th century.
Yeah.
And then I'm right through the history of Palitoy. And you'll see some of the, as you scroll through this here, you'll see some of the black and white photos, which have come from various sources. So that's, I mentioned there earlier, part of the work myself and Bob have been doing prior to the Kickstarter has been trying to source a lot of visual material to back up the story, that the brilliant story that Bob has written. Trying to find photos that there'll be some photos that are famous and collectors will have seen them many times, but you know, we're hoping that's going to be photos in there, and we feel confident there'll be photos in there that collectors have never seen before. And
I was gonna disagree with you on that, because you did send me a press pack with some photos in it, and I was like, I've never seen those photos before, and it's like, this one, I've never seen that one before, of this lady packing the attack, which I've got on my shelf just there. Funny enough, it looks exactly like that because it's missing the top and the guns. So that could be that. That could be that one actually right there. Yeah, looks just like it, without the guns, without the top. Yeah, covered in one. And funny, do you know, that was one toy my mum didn't get her hands on because it was selling out fast as anything.
Wow.
But okay, she managed to get me so much else from Palitoy. But it's great. Do you know, when you look at these photos, you go, if you only knew how much that's worth now. You know what I mean? Like a box full of guns, because they go for loads of money, don't they, the guns and stuff. And there's just like, oh, yeah, just pack them. They're all there. Oh, well, my God.
You know, I've interviewed some former Palitoy staff, and they, you know, more than one has said to me that maybe he should have loaded up his car, the boot of his car, with a few bits and pieces from the factory, you know, and it would have sorted him out for his retirement now.
Yes. Well, funny enough, that's one of the stories that, well, the story, how I got my Star Wars, if you indulge me on the story, Brian, I'll just remove that so we're on, is that my mum, she worked at the local bingo hall in Leicester. And of course, she's got all the people coming into the bingo, but a lot of people from Palitoy came to her bingo hall. And there was one lady, I'd love to know what her name was, because I have to thank her for it. You know what I mean? She comes up to my mum and says to me, because she's been buying, she's always got a boot full of action figures, she'll say, yeah? And she always had Action Man, and my mum was, she'll say, Pauline, I've got some stuff in my car if you want to come around and have a look. And my mum would go, yeah, right. So she'd be selling the tickets, and when she gets 5 minutes, she'd go out and have a look in the boot of her car. And she picked up, like, the Action Man helicopter, the Jeep, figures, you know, everything, all like that. But one day, she went up, and this lady said to me, mum, she goes, I've got something in my boot that I'm not too sure if it's going to be, if it's what your son's into, but it's brand new. We're just about to launch it. And my mum was like, oh, what is it? So she opened a boot and she saw all this Star Wars stuff. And my mum immediately knew, because she went, I think my son might be interested in this. Yeah, yeah. So she literally bought the whole lot straight off her. So she bought the Millennium Falcon. She bought the Death Star, the cardboard Death Star. I wish I had that now. Right, the cardboard Death Star. She bought the sand crawler, the cardboard sand crawler. The cantina, and loads and loads of figures. And there was one figure.
They're great play sets you mentioned there, because Palitoy did their own kind of unique takes on the Land of the Jawas and the Cantina. They're slightly different from the Kenner versions released in the States.
Are they?
They are. So they're different.
I didn't realize that.
The material is different, but also there's some small kind of changes in the actual components themselves. So the Palitoy Land of the Jawas didn't actually come with the capsule.
Do you know what? Funny you should say that, because I'm looking at that and I was thinking, I can't remember the capsule. I really can't, because I remember the cardboard building it, unless my memory's gone fuzzy. Because I remember building the cardboard, sticking it in with the little lift that comes down, and it came with a cloth Jawa. You know what I mean? It came with the cape. I'm sure it had the cloth cape on it. And I would, do you know, those play sets, I loved them. Absolutely loved them. And when I had that Death Star, that was,
yes,
you know, and my brother, he stood on it and smashed it up in a fit of rage once. Well, we were kids, I forgive him for it. I told him he's got to buy me a new one, though. Another one,
My brothers flew my Millennium Falcon out of the bedroom window. So,
I've got all my. I must have had my brain switched on with it, because most of my Star Wars, I've now got all my vintage stuff is all boxed up, wrapped up, and I've got no end of stuff still in the boxes. You know what I mean? Which I kept. I don't know why, but I thought I've got to keep them in the boxes, not get rid of them, and all the cards. I was just looking around for it, because I've got a couple of vintage bits and bobs, you know, like this kind of thing.
MTB7 gloves.
This, I think, is now canon. I'm sure it was in a cartoon or in a comic.
Really? Wow, that's brilliant.
But it was in the comic, in it, it's like that going along.
Yeah.
but I've not seen it. It could be in the new Star Wars Visions, but I've not seen all of them yet.
I've only seen the first two, so I'm looking forward to getting stuck into that.
I've seen like three.
Fantastic.
Yeah. I've seen three, and I went straight to the Hardman one, yeah. Which one did you just say?
The first one I went to was the Carnival or Cartoon Saloon.
Cartoon Saloon.
That's the Irish animation company. So I think that's the second one in the series.
Yes. I went to that one as well.
Really good to see that. And I'm looking forward to watching the Aardman one. That's big fan of kind of the Wallace and Gromit and Chicken Run movies.
Wow, so, yeah. If you've not seen it yet, I won't spoil it for you, but there will be a moment where you go that meme on me. Okay. Me and my son did it at the same time. I was like, yeah. So I won't spoil it, but it's good. But I've not seen them all. Of course, where's the other thing that I have? So usually, yeah, unless my son's picked it up. I've got me original. I've got so much around me. Oh, there it is. It's just there. Hold on. See if this stretches. Sorry, guys. All over. Yeah, that's... Sorry, Artie. Right, that is my... So I've got this, yeah. And that is my original one that my mum bought me. C-3PO.
Out of the boot of a car.
Out of the boot of a car, yeah. But do you know what? I can't express how this one figure means so much to me, because it was one... She saved it all for Christmas. And I remember sort of hearing something in the middle of the night, because my mum believed in putting stuff at the end of my bed in a big sack. And I remember hearing something. So I woke up and I looked down. I could see the card of Star Wars just out. So I reached down trying to be really quiet, and I slid it out of the bag, and the moon was coming through. The moonshine was coming through the moonlight, should I say, was coming through the window, and it shone him up. And I went, like that. And me mum went, Jamie. I was like, pretend to be asleep. But so I've kept him. He's always been with me. He's not been in a box. He's been out with me.
Brilliant.
Oh, figures, there's something about them that just, take you back when you pick them up and hold them. They bring back so many memories that it's hard to get. You know, when you hear about collectors getting rid of their collections because they're growing up, I think it's so hard. Even though I've not touched them in 10, 15 years, maybe. I'd feel a loss if they go, because I know where they are. Yeah. Even though I don't go to them, if they're not there, then I'll know it. And I know it'd be a big hole gone. Do you know what I mean? And I can see you've got a lot of stuff, collectibles behind you. You know what I mean? So I can understand that you'll be the same, really.
I mean, I've got a mix of kind of, modern and vintage stuff there. And that's only that wall. There's a wall over there that's not on camera. So, and then there's whatever's not on display, I don't have any of my original childhood stuff. When I went off to college, my parents moved house while I was away, and during the house move they did a big clear.
Oh my God.
Skip, and they dumped loads of stuff, which included all of my toys. So Action Force, Action Man, Star Wars, Black Hole figures.
Oh my God.
I had an old Bob Black Hole figure. They just everything ditched, and I at the time I didn't really care. I was in college, I was into music, I was playing guitar, I was in a band, and I was having great fun, and toys was the last thing on my mind. But it was probably in the noughties when I started having, when I became a dad and my own kids were kind of starting to get toys as gifts, it sort of brought me all back, and the collecting began again for me. Started off on eBay, and today, most of the stuff I get is probably through the various groups on Facebook. That's where I collect now. But I got back everything I had as a kid except that black hole. Bob, except that. and more, you know. And so I've plenty of toys to keep me busy.
Do you know, there's one that I'm particular, you know, I keep having like a slidey little look on eBay and stuff like that. It's totally random, and I can't remember if it was by Kenner or Hasbro or Palitoy, but it was a Mork and Mindy. Do you remember the old Mork that came in an egg for Mork and Mindy?
Yeah. Well, I remember the TV show, but I don't remember the toy for that. Wow.
Yeah, they did a toy, like they did a 3 3/4 figure in an egg, which was a ship, and I loved it. And I don't know whatever happened to it, but I keep having a look, you know, thinking if I see it cheap enough, I'm going to get it. I know one's coming back to me. I know.
I've seen one of those on Instagram there recently. It could be Steve Evans on Instagram. Is Mr. Stevie 18, I think, is his handle. And he's got a great toy display behind him, you know, in his kind of in his room, his toy room. But I think he's got a Mork with the spaceship in there. I think it's his channel I saw.
All right. Mine just looks like a mess. I've got so much of it. I've just run out of space. I mean, plus I'm into retro gaming as well, and I'm trying to find some place for bits and bobs and a 3D print as well. And it's like, and I've got all this above me as well. You know what I mean? It's just everywhere. It's just overspilling. Ugh. And the Lego, of course. I've got the big Lego Falcon.
See the Falcon behind you there? And is that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Look at that. That's great.
Yeah. And I've got the Razor Quest there. They brought out.
Yeah. Wow.
I had to go for that. I just had to for that. And what you can't see is I've got a Proton Pack there as well. I don't know if you can see it. Proton Pack as well. There we go.
Exactly. And is that a DeLorean? Yeah. Behind you.
Yes. Yeah, that one. This one is only that one they brought out a couple of years ago. I think you know, you press the button on top. I've got put batteries in it, but you press it and all the lights all shine up in it. The wheels that turn on it. Does it? Yeah. 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 Well, yeah, the wheels turn on it. Yeah, they turn on it eventually. I think I might have to grease it up, actually. And some other bits and bobs, but yeah. But I did pick up that you can just see it just there. Is that George Lucas Stormtrooper figure?
Oh, that's a great figure, yeah.
Yeah, I picked that up and it was only like 11 quid. So I thought, yeah, I'm having that. And and then I went down, I bought a special clear box for it at Star Wars Celebrations for £2. So I thought, yeah, okay. So I put that into that. Nice. And some other bits and bobs. But it's, and I've been buying some of the retro figures as well. The new from The Mandalorian. I bought some of them, but the retro ones, and they're on the wall up there as well. So I've slowly got back into collecting after a massive, like, 25 years gap, but it's always been on my mind. And well, it gives it something for the kids once I'm gone. You know what I mean? Once I'm gone, it gives the kids their retirement fund. You know what I mean? Not mine, but theirs. Yeah. Yeah. But get back onto this book. These scenes, these pictures are fantastic, Brian. But it's not all about Star Wars. It goes from the beginning, doesn't it? From the aspects, from the creation of Palitoy, doesn't it?
Well, do you know what? It actually looks at the, I suppose that, yeah, of course, you had the creation of Palitoy, which began as Castelloid in 1919. But it looks as well at the birth of the toy industry. Because humans have been producing toys for millennia.
Yeah.
But actually having like an industry focused around creating toys and marketing and distributing toys, that Bob's book describes how that whole thing began, looking at different kind of manufacturers kind of around Europe and in America at the very, say, in the late 19th century and into the early 20th century. And this is kind of what sets up Alfred Palit kind of creating the company Castelloid, which was producing both industrial plastics and producing toys as well. So And then it looks at how that whole industry evolved, how it affected Castelloyd. And then when Castelloyd was acquired by a bigger British plastics company, they consolidated its Castelloyd's toy division into Colville in Leicestershire. And then that was sold off to General Mills in the 1960s. And that's what would become Palitoy, that we would be familiar with, say, in the 70s and 80s. And it gives you that whole history. And then Star Wars is a big player in the whole story, because the success of the Star Wars toys in the 70s and 80s kind of set a benchmark for how, a global toy brand could be designed, produced, marketed, and distributed. And the General Toy Mills group, of which Palitoy was a part of, was going to create and set the standards for that model. And that ultimately was the beginning of the end for Palitoy. And all of the unique innovation and unique design that was happening in Colville was all swept aside and then replaced by the design and creative coming out of New York. So, Bob tells that story, but he tells it in a, you know, it's a very unbiased manner. He just tells it like it is. He doesn't come across as being kind of disappointed or lamenting, you know, how it affected his career. It's a really interesting story. The birth of an industry, the birth of a company, the rise and fall of that company, and then how the toy industry is the way it is today. It's all mapped out in that book. There's so much in there that it's a remarkable piece of work from Bob's part. So my job really is to create a book that is as visually compelling as it is compelling from the written point of view. So we've got great material that we can work with visually. You can see there on the image that's on the screen right now, that image, we actually got that from a personal collection. That's Bob Simpson there, the man on the right in that photo. And Bob was the guy who was responsible for consolidating Castelloyd's toy division into one body that would and make it attractive so that they could sell it in at some point in the future. That was his job. So he really is the father of Palitoy. If Alfred Palit is the grandfather or the godfather of Palitoy, he's the daddy right there. Bob. Call him Bob Simpson. Miles Fletcher is the gentleman's name, and I call him Bob Simpson by mistake. But Miles Fletcher, so Miles's wife was in contact with Bob and very generously gave us access to a lot of photos from her personal collection, which we later discovered were originally taken by DC Thompson Publishers. So we were able to go back to DC Thompson, and by scanning the photographs at high res and returning the digital versions to DC Thompson, they gave us the license to use those particular images at no cost in the book. So that was a great discovery for by Bob, that was greatly benefits the project and was also beneficial to the original licensors of those images.
Slight pause there. I have to admit, this Palitoy book, I'm gonna have to back it. As soon as I get paid, I'm gonna have to back it, because just the look of it looks fantastic, because the cover brings back so many memories as well. Do you know what I mean? And did you put that together?
That's a collage of different photos. Some of those photos are my own. There's a couple there that have been, generously given permission by the respective collectors to feature those photos. And then also the Vectis Auctions have agreed to let Bob use any of the images from their library of vintage toys in the book as well, so we'll be able to represent visually pretty much anything that was produced by Palitoy during that 60s, 70s, 80s period.
Do you know that Robo School? I remember seeing it, but what's it from?
That's from Action Force.
Yeah. I remember it, but I can't, because I looked at your books and I needed a proper refresh with Action Force, because I was thinking, I know it, but I can't remember it. But I remember, I know the name, but as soon as I saw that, I'm thinking, I'm sure that's it. I'm sure that's it. But with this book then, Brian, so if you back it with the, how much is it to back it?
Well, right now, there is an early bird right now, but that's going to finish in about 15 minutes time, the early bird reward option. But at the early bird point, €55 plus shipping. But the standard price is to get a copy of the physical copy of the book is €65 plus shipping. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure what that translates to into pounds. But obviously, it might be like 55, 56 pounds or whatever way that translates. And then there's a couple of other awards there, there's a signed version of the book. There's an award to get two copies of the book, so to get slightly discounted price. And then what we'll be revealing over later in the campaign will be a bonus exclusive poster and a set of postcard prints, which will feature some of the different toys from Palitoy's catalog. So they're not on the campaign page just yet, but I would say keep an eye on the page next week, and we'll start revealing those as we work through the latter weeks of the campaign.
That is fantastic. I will put a link to the to this Kickstarter on the description, so for the listeners and the viewers, they can just click below and go straight to the Kickstarter and pledge and get a copy of this book, because it's going to be one of them books that if you don't get it, you're going to miss out. It's literally a physical history from somebody who lived it. They're not gone. They're here. Yeah, I mean, is there, I have to ask, is there going to be an audio version of it in Bob's own words with it?
Well, there's no plans to do kind of like an audio book version of it at this time. But, you never say never, right? Never say never.
That's true. That's true.
But one thing to note about Kickstarter, for people who maybe are not familiar with the Kickstarter platform, if you pledge now, your credit card or your debit card won't be charged right away. The cards are only charged after the campaign ends. And in this case, it'll end on June 18th. And cards will only be charged if we achieve our funding goal. So if we didn't achieve the funding goal, no cards will be charged. And of course, if we do, and we're very hopeful that we will achieve the funding goal, then at that stage, when the campaign ends on June 18th, immediately all the cards will be charged at that stage. So you don't have to wait till payday to back the book. You can back the book now, and then it'll be billed when the campaign is finished.
Fantastic. Now, I know you're really short on time, and I appreciate that you've come on. So I want to quickly rip over to you to some other bits and bobs you've got. Now, you did an interview a couple of years ago with Fantatrax, and we love Fantatrax here, with some of your photography using Star Wars toys, which I absolutely love. And in fact, if many of the viewers and listeners know that at Star Wars Celebrations, there was a poster that you could get with Hasbro figures, Darth Vader and a Luke Skywalker in the Emperor's throne room having a fight, that you could buy in the official art show. So this is quite good, because everybody's had these toys. Now, with this photo here, it's brilliant. It's the original X-Wing. And that, if I'm not mistaken, is the die-cast Millennium Falcon in the background.
That's correct. The die-cast. Yeah. My modest die-cast collections back there, but it's I love the die-cast Falcon. It's a brilliant, brilliant little vehicle.
Yeah. I'm sure in my box I've got that. I've got the snow speeder, and I've got the Imperial Star Destroyer. I'm sure I have. I think I've got the little plastic tentative as well underneath it. I think I have. This is a great shot. I love this shot. Because at first when I looked at it, I honestly thought it was a live action photography, and they've actually created R2. Wouldn't that be the beans if they actually made that look of R2 canon in a Star Wars episode? You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't have to be R2, but call it P-I-T-Y, maybe. I mean, yeah. Might have to build one. But I like that shot. That must have been ages to get that shot right.
Well, you know, with all of my shots, the thing is, I try to not use any Photoshop or CGI for the effects. So say that previous image that was up there of the Death Star blowing up, that's all in camera. There's no it's not added later in Photoshop. And to get the vehicles kind of, you know, floating or flying, you know, to make it look as if they're there, they're all precariously placed on kind of stands protruding out of the explosion and then lining up the camera so that the stands are hidden.
Right.
So a shot like that is really difficult to do. And let's just say there might be more than a few swear words every time something falls down.
Yeah.
So the shot of 3PO and R2 is actually a pretty easy shot to do. And that little kind of window that they're looking out, like the window of the escape pod,
yeah,
that's off like a fitting off this old, we had this kind of like playhouse, plastic playhouse out in the back garden that the kids didn't play with anymore. And it was all bits of it broken off.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
That's one of the broken bits, which I just spray painted gray.
Amazing.
And I was able to set up the shot really, really simple. So that's an easy one by comparison.
Yeah.
But it's all about trying to, you know, build the props, build the set pieces with the brief I give myself is how would 10-year-old me have done it?
Yeah.
So I have to use kind of stuff that I could have used as a 10-year-old. So yeah. Stuff I can find, basic arts and crafts, and then to try and actually make it look good in camera.
Who would have thought egg boxes would be exactly what you needed for that shot there?
They just have that lovely industrial kind of look.
Yeah, they do, didn't they?
Yeah, you know, and if you do a side by side comparison with the live action, you know, scene from the film, you know, of course they don't look, you know, accurate. But it's just to get that, you know, just for that split second to get that sense of, oh yeah, that's what that scene is. But there's great texture in them, and I just thought, yeah, they were a no-brainer to use for that particular scene.
Absolutely. I used to use, do you know packing styrofoam? Do you know when you get like a TV out of the box?
Yes.
The styrofoam was molded to the TV. I used to get that and have that as snow for Hoff. Do you know what I mean? Absolutely. I put my figures in it. So this kind of thing really, it's. You know, I did this, I could say. And I suppose with many of people who go and access this kind of thing will go, yeah, I've done that. Are these photos I'm going through, are these ones in that book that you showed me?
They're all those images are in the not the book with Bob Brecken, but separately there's a book called Star Wars Creating Adventure, which is photography. Yeah, this book here, so it's photography that I've taken.
Yeah.
Where I've recreated every scene from the original trilogy with the vintage toys.
Yeah.
So like in those photos you've seen there, it's all practical effects. It's all in camera. And you know, simple dioramas that I've kind of, you know, made that my 10-year-old self would have been able to make, maybe with a little bit of help from a grown up.
Yeah. This book is free. I will a digital book, should I say, is free to have a look at, and I'll and if with your permission, Brian, I'll just put a link to this as well.
Please do.
On it.
Please
yeah, do. So people can. And I'd love it how you could just like flick them. Look at that, flick them pages. How cool is that? I tell you, that's so good. Who's this? Who's this?
Oh, that's actually my youngest son.
Mm.
And he kind of looks, I used to have a bit more hair than I have now. So that's kind of how it looked back in, 1982. So yeah. We just thought that would be a nice way to show kind of that transformation for me, how I played with toys as a kid to how I play with toys today. And I do very much see my photography as me still playing with toys.
Don't blame me. I would have done the same thing myself. It looks fantastic. Because I did think, I'm like, is he CGI'd himself as a little kid looking at it? Because I've got a photo of me playing the original Star Wars arcade machine. And I put it, showed it to my, you know, went back in the day. And I showed it to my son. And he went, God, you look just like me. And I went, yeah, isn't it creepy? Weird. It's like, you're there. Strange, isn't it?
Well, what I love about this is that I took the photograph on the left and then my son took the photograph of me on the right. So it's nice how that works.
It looks good. I love this. This is great. Yeah. Some of the, of course, another one of those Palitoy, was it a Kenner? Was that one by Kenner?
I'm pretty sure that was the Kenner mini rig. Yeah. I don't think Palitoys really, you know, they only produced, would have been their original Star Wars toys would have been very early in the process. After that, they were just rolling out the Kenner stuff.
Yeah. This book, yeah, I'm going to go through this book, you know, on my laptop downstairs. I have to say, Brian, this is a remarkable book, you know, maybe with the pages. And the toy, because I've got that toy. I'll be like, yeah. Got that one. Yep, got that one. So I can't wait to go for this one. And considering it's free online, can you not buy this book? Can you get like a physical hard copy of this book?
But unfortunately not, because the book is very clearly retelling the story of Star Wars, it would highly likely be illegal for me to sell it because I'd be infringing on Lucasfilm's IP. So the only way this would ever exist in a physical form for sale would be if I got a license directly from Lucasfilm or by a publisher who already had a license to do books like this, if they decided to take it on.
It is.
In the introduction, I'd kind of detail the whole journey of how this book came to be.
Yeah. Oh, I can't wait to read it. Do you know, it's nostalgia and it's taken me. Oh, I used to have that speeder. I used to love it. I used to love the sound of the bouncing wheels with the springs. Oh man, it's a beautiful book. I'll tell you what, definitely. I'm going to post a link, like I say, so we can have a really good look at that. Now, there we go. Right. So on this website, totaltoybooks.com. Now it's got your Action Force books here as well. So you've got the Total Action Force, the Battle Years, and Total Action Force Volume 2. Can you tell me a bit about these two as well? And these are physical ones you can buy, aren't they?
These are physical books you can buy. So both of these books were funded, the production of them was funded through prospective Kickstarter campaigns. We did a hardback of Total Action Force, the Battle Years, myself and Paddy Lennon and David MacDonald back in 2021. Mm-hmm. And that sold out. Like, we only produced enough books to fulfill the rewards for the Kickstarter campaign. So once everybody got their books, there was only a small handful of books left over, and they were like maybe five or six, and they were quickly kind of snapped up by people who missed the campaign.
Okay.
And then that deals with the Palitoy story of Action Force. So how Palitoy developed Action Force as a response to the success of the Star Wars action figures. And then how that kind of toy line evolved while Palitoy had kind of ownership over that. And then volume two, which we funded and produced last year in 2022 via Kickstarter, picks up then where volume one leaves off. So it's Hasbro get control of the Action Force IP, and then they introduce their G.I. Joe product branded as Action Force into the UK market. And both books look at the toys, but they also look at the comics associated with them, because the comics were a big way of kind of marketing the toys.
Yeah.
And they look at the people behind both the comics and the toys in each case.
Yeah.
So that was a big part of the book for me, to make sure the designers, writers, and artists all got got the spotlight on them as part of the Action Force story.
Is the this artwork on the front of these books, are they original new artwork or old artwork, should I say?
Well, in the case of Action Force, Total Action Force, the Battle Years, that's all classic artwork by Vanyo and Gual, taken from the Battle Action Force comics, and all of that was, you know, reproduced with permission from Rebellion Publishing, who own that artwork now. But in the case of Volume 2, we commissioned a new piece from the artist Mike Collins. And Mike Collins would have been an original Action Marvel UK Action Force artist in the late 80s.
Yeah.
So Mike, who's still very, you know, active professionally today, very graciously came on board to do that. And he illustrated that cover for us. And it's we wanted it to kind of mirror somewhat the Volume 1 style, but to put the focus on the bad guys. And Mike did a brilliant job. He just knocked it out of the park.
Yeah, yeah, it's good. And they look good together. You know what I mean? It's the sort of artwork, it'd be nice framed. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Back to, you know, side to side sort of thing. I do like it. I do like it. In fact, like I said at the beginning, when I said, actually, no, I could hardly remember it. I'm going to have to go back and start looking it up. It's made me want to, like, do a dive into it. Because you're right, there was a comic book of it, wasn't there, as well?
That's right. Battle Action Force for the Palitoy. And then when Hasbro took over, they had an Action Force comic through Marvel UK. So there's, and to be honest, they're brilliant comics, both whether they were Marvel UK or IPC magazines. They're brilliant, and definitely worth picking up.
I always thought that this was the UK version of G.I. Joe, that was, you know, with the, you know, when G.I. Joe went kind of fantasy sort of thing. I thought that was what it was at first. Like, it was just like, instead of using G.I. Joe, they changed it to Action Force.
Well, eventually that is what did happen when Marvel took over. But when Palitoy created Action Force first, it was its own unique designs based on it was their own property, and they developed their own property, their own teams, their own kind of mythology behind them. They did have a contract with, or a licensing agreement with Hasbro on the Action Man brand, because Action Man, as you know, you're aware, is that the 12-inch G.I. Joe. So they used that that licensing deal to, as Action Force developed, they fleshed it out with some Hasbro G.I. Joe vehicles and a couple of figures. But for the most part, it was still, you know, primarily Palitoy designed toys. But when the design department closed in 1984, and this is all detailed in Bob's book, Palitoy wasn't producing any new material at that stage. And then that licensing agreement with Hasbro kicked in full. And it was just all Hasbro product coming in 1985. Then Hasbro effectively, the Action Force IP was assigned to Hasbro in 1986, late 1986. And at which stage then Hasbro just took over. They obtained the Action Force brand and then just pushed all of their own products into the UK market at that stage. But because Action Force had really good brand equity in the market, they retained that rather than calling the figures G.I. Joe.
Could you see Action Force coming back as figures? Because it seems to be an awful lot, because kids nowadays don't buy action figures, but adults do.
You know,
it could be a property that people would have again.
Absolutely, there's a huge interest in Action Force, both in on this side of the Atlantic, our side of the Atlantic. We have all that nostalgia associated with it, and we have that passion still for it. But on the American side of the Atlantic, many collectors are only recently becoming aware of what Action Force was, and they're realizing that it's not just reissues or repaints of G.I. Joe, that there's a lot more to it. The Robo Skull, obviously being, you know, one of the landmark vehicles to come out of Palitoy. There's a lot of interest for that. And of course, the enemy faction associated with the Robo Skull, the Red Shadows, are again, it's an iconic toy design. And for me, I think the design is what makes them so kind of what piques the interest of collectors today.
Yeah.
So I definitely think the scope there for Action Force to have some sort of resurgence. You can see that Super 7 have reissued a red laser as part of their recent kind of 5POA G.I. Joe figures. So yeah. Red Laser is an Action Force bad guy. And then, you know, in recent years, the G.I. Joe Collectors Club had some key Action Force figures kind of released as part of their kind of, you know, their modern articulation, you know, fully articulated figures. So they had a Jammer, a Gaucho. They did a Red Laser as well, you know, a couple of figures like that. So the interest has never gone away. It's still there. And I think now is as good a time as any for the real explosion of, you know, of that kind of original Action Force for that to come back out. It'd be a great time.
I'm thinking, considering that Hollywood are looking for new IP, Action Force, you know what I mean? Especially, you know, can you imagine like Netflix or something like getting on and producing an Action Force movie series based in the UK, maybe, you know what I mean? Also, they've got the money. People are just going, yeah, well, it's a bit as long as they made it good. But better than the G.I. Joe films, you know what I mean? But let's make it Action Force with you know, let's get back to it. Because it's got every element you would want. It's got the fantasy, it's got the sort of the Marvel kind of look with certain bad guys and certain shipping. It's got ships, cars, it's got everything. To me, it's a no-brainer on that one. I mean, why has nobody gone, hey, do you know, let's just put superheroes back a bit. Let's bring this kind of stuff forward and have a go at this. I don't know why they don't do it. It'd be interesting. Maybe we could get the word out there. Hashtag bring back Action Force. There you
happy
go.
Days. Let's do it. Yeah.
Yeah. Hashtag bring back happy. Hashtag bring back Action Force the movie. Yeah. Yeah. That's a good one. Do you know, talking about the Palitoy brand, Hasbro brought out the retro series that which I was collecting, why I think they would have absolutely sold more units in this country if they put the Palitoy logo on. I don't know if they own the Palitoy logo, but imagine if they put that bit on. Because I look at them and think, it says Kenner. I wish I could get the little sticker that I could put over there. You know what I mean?
In theory, they do. I mean, the Palitoy logo and the Kenner logo, I mean, they were two separate groups in the overall kind of General Mills toy group, which was then kind of spun off as Kenner Parker. So Tonka acquired Kenner Parker and then Hasbro acquired Tonka. So if they own the Kenner identity, you can be damn sure they own the Palitoy identity as well. You know, but yeah, you're absolutely right. That would be for us collectors over here. The Palitoy logo would be something really cool to see on.
Yeah, it'd be the cherry on the top of that cake. Yeah. One other thing I want to ask you is, does Bob know where they're all buried in Colville?
Oh, he does.
He does.
You can't reveal that information. That's John Holmes, actually, who was the manufacturing manager at Palitoy, did reveal to me where they were buried. But they're under tons and tons of concrete. Like, nobody's getting them out.
Hey, if they got those Atari ET cartridges out, they can bloody well dig these up. Because I remember seeing it on TV, them dumping them, and I remember it being in the Leicester Mercury, and it said, and I've got a rough idea where they are myself, and because I spoke to Matt Fox, I think it's Matt Fox of May the Toys Be With You, you know, that he did a thing, and I was saying, I said to him, I could have sworn they were here, and he was like, that's really interesting because I've heard that before. I was like, all right. But I was just going on what I've seen. And I've been on the internet and I scoured. Couldn't find any articles about it. But I know perhaps it's that I was going to say the Mandalorian then. The Mandalorian effect where you think you've seen it, but you've not. But I could have sworn I have.
here's one for you now. You could go on to the British Newspaper Archive. Great website, an absolutely brilliant website. And now it is a subscription service, but I think you get your first couple of searches for free.
All right.
And you could search for the Leicester Mercury around the time that you think that is, right? Mm. And see, can you find, because if that was in the paper, it's on the British Newspaper Archive website. It's a great resource. We use that for a lot of our research on these books. So that's one to look for. But John Holmes did say to me that they were put down abandoned mining shafts. The toys were all dumped down there and then filled in with tons of concrete. So I think ever recovering them is probably unlikely. And they could be wrecked. Whatever's down there could be wrecked. It was recoverable.
I can't believe they just dumped them. The amount of kids that just looked at the TV and was like, what? You know what I mean? Oh, it's breaking, isn't it? That's brilliant, Brian. Thank you for coming on on the show and talking Star Wars Action Force and, of course, my Palitoy story by yourself and Bob. It's been absolutely fantastic. And like I say, I'm going to stick all the links below. If you've got any links yourself that you want to send to me, I'll be quite happy and stick them below. If any of the viewers or the listeners of the podcast want to see you, what's the quickest way of getting on to, you know, to seeing your work or getting in contact?
Well, if you want to get in touch with me, instagram.com/BrianTheHick is my Instagram account. Also then Total Toy Books on Facebook, and then totaltoybooks.com, the website. So all the different kind of contact links and photos, books, all that, you'll find them there.
Oh, brilliant. Thank you again. Thank you again, Brian, for coming on, and good luck on the book. And I hope to see some more stuff coming out from you in the future. Okay.
Jamie, thank you so much. Have a great evening.
And you too. Take care.